What about it? Is there an evil spirit world holding sway over man? Is Satan just a figment of an overly active imagination? Are there answers to these questions? Yes, there are, and I believe the next 30 minutes will shock you. Let's begin with an update on current interest in the supernatural. Not in recent history have we experienced such an explosion in occult-related books, movies, and music. Bookstores sell gruesome horror tales by the boxful. Every year, film production companies in Hollywood and other places produce chilling, seemingly realistic accounts of twisted, demonic behavior. And these movies rake in millions. Again, for a relatively small price, home computer owners can buy programs allowing them to enter worlds where magic and demonic powers are key elements. And even science fiction is only a very small step away from the demon world. There are equal, if not greater, numbers of books and movies about strange beings of awesome power who control or influence human beings. In one very popular sci-fi presentation, Aliens, an interesting statement is made. Ripley, the heroine, is comforting a young girl found alive in the carnage left by violent, serpent-like beings. In one of the quieter moments of the movie, the little girl tells Ripley how her mother often told her that there were no such things as monsters. The little girl says, "My mommy said there were no monsters, no real ones, but there are." The camera switches to Ripley, who looks at the girl and says softly, "Yes, there are." This scene actually has deep significance for what we're talking about. Aliens is fictional, but as we'll see in today's program, there really are beings that want to destroy humanity. Perverse beings that are strongly committed to denying men and women their opportunity to have a full, abundant life. Today, I want to invite you to think about all of this from a different perspective. You see, there was a time when the evil spirit world was not just the stuff of movie fantasies. To our forebears, it was reality. Many of our ancestors believed Satan to be the literal personification of evil. But today, much of society has come to regard Satan the devil as a cartoon figure of fun, a fellow in a red suit with a pitchfork, or the subject of scary movies and books, certainly not a being to be taken seriously. Some jokingly say, "The devil made me do it." Until, that is, we're brought up short by testimony in a grisly murder trial where the apparently demented accused says the same thing, "Satan told me to do it." And then we begin to wonder again. Well, is Satan a real being? Does he exert actual influence over this world we live in? How do you explain some of the real-life horror that takes place, some of the evil reported in our news every day? Here's an article from Tennessee headlined, "Rumors of Satanic Cult Circulating in Area." This one comes from California. Psychologists report satanic crimes rising. This one from Denmark. 200 Danes worship Satan. Another from Britain. Church fears rise of Satanists. This from Chicago. Satan worship called dangerous, growing. And finally from Cincinnati. Satanism, public fascination and fear growing over topic of devil worship. Now, Satan is not a mystery to some. Both the Bible and the Quran say that Satan was present in the Garden of Eden soon after man's creation. Jesus Christ certainly believed he was real. He said in Luke chapter 10 and verse 18, "I saw Satan fall as lightning from heaven." Indeed, Christ spoke a great deal about Satan. But I said I wanted you to think about it from a different perspective today. Let me ask you this. If you were someone's secret enemy, what would you do to destroy that individual without being detected? Now add another thought. What if your enemy were the whole of mankind? How would you go about it? Remember, you mustn't be detected, if at all possible. Oh, and there's one other condition. You will not be allowed to bring mankind to the point of total annihilation for 6,000 years. Would you perhaps begin by convincing man that you didn't really exist? You might then deceive your enemy into destroying himself slowly. You might make the wrong ways of making progress seem right, and the right ways seem wrong. Take, for example, man's food supply. You might convince him that pouring billions of tons of fertilizers, pesticides and herbicides on farmland would solve his hunger problems. You might persuade him to live in the midst of polluted air and water in the pursuit of material happiness. You might take advantage of his desire for wholesome new experiences and convince him that mind-altering substances are beneficial. You might encourage him to make ever more powerful weapons to preserve peace, inviting him to believe they would never be used. In other words, you'd set out to subvert him in every conceivable way, yet persuade him that he was doing the best thing for himself. That would be the greatest deception of all, wouldn't it? Persuade him to destroy himself in the pursuit of happiness, all the while not knowing what he was doing to himself. Now, does that ring any bells? Does it sound familiar? Look at the world we live in and what we're facing in this latter part of the 20th century. We rip open the earth for its minerals, abuse its surface, and wonder why our resources are dwindling. We rape the land with injurious farming methods. Each day, hundreds, even thousands of tons of pollutants are cast into our drinking water and are found in the food that we eat and the air that we breathe. There's erosion, expanding deserts, deforestation, all man-made. While the industrialized world lives in relative comfort and convenience, about half of the human race suffers largely unseen. Consider violence for a moment. Is this a violent age? In the eyes of many, the carnage of World War I was so repulsive that many proclaimed it to be the war that would end all wars. But did humanity learn its lesson? Humanity limped along for about two decades, and suddenly, to the disbelief of many, the unthinkable erupted again. But this time, the destruction was even worse. In World War II, weapons had advanced. The airplane, previously scorned by military experts, proved to be a potent means of effectively targeting and destroying the enemy. It was the airplane that delivered the ultimate weapon and broke the spirit of a determined Japanese resistance. Now, much has been said and written about the incredible destructive potential of nuclear weapons. But did you know that since 1945, the Soviet Union, the United Kingdom, France, the United States, and the People's Republic of China have exploded more than 814 nuclear devices and weapons in testing? Meanwhile, thousands of warheads atop missiles and in the cargo bays of sophisticated supersonic aircraft await delivery. The combined punch of these weapons provides the equivalent of 4 tons of dynamite for each person on Earth. Does this sound like the product of rational, peace-loving minds? Oh, our genius helped us split the atom, but we used our knowledge to create weapons that could ultimately destroy us. We're at the point where we can commit violence against the entire planet. We can create the nightmare of a nuclear winter in major food-producing areas of the world. But we help ourselves cope with this terrifying scenario by putting forth the belief that nuclear war is unthinkable. Nobody would be so stupid as to start a nuclear war, we say. Thomas Powers, an American essayist, in his book, Thinking About the Next War, made this observation. The world's great armies have always gone to war sooner or later. The great fleet of Darius, the Roman legions, the Spanish Armada, and the Wehrmacht were all intended for war, and that is what they were used for. He concludes with this disturbing question. Why should the present situation end any differently? Does it make sense to you that rational human beings would develop such a situation without outside interference? Whether we realize it or not, a drama of worldwide proportions is being played out every day in the battle for our minds. I said earlier that the Bible has much to say about the devil, called Satan, the adversary, and the destroyer in various places. The Bible's record of Satan's nature and activities is key to understanding why the world is the way it is, and why man has found himself in continuing crises since creation. Now, it isn't a hopeless case, but understanding what's really going on behind the scenes is the beginning of the way out of deception. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 9 says this. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Understanding Satan's deception is the first step in coming to terms with man's dance with the devil. This free booklet, Did God Create a Devil?, will open your eyes to reality. The first chapter answers the question of Satan's origin. Was he created? If not, how did he become the adversary? The next chapter asks whether there is a spirit world. Is there anything out there beyond what we can physically detect? Satan has become a superstar at the box office in the last few years. Demonic movies are popular and profitable. But are they just harmless entertainment? Most of us think we're living in reality. But the Bible says we've been blinded, deceived. We owe it to ourselves to find out how and why and what the truth really is. This booklet, Did God Create a Devil?, is yours free. No charge whatsoever and no obligation. Along with it, if you're not already a subscriber, then we'll be sending you the Plain Truth magazine. I'll be offering these free publications again at the end of today's program. Now let's get back to our analysis of mankind's dance with the devil on today's Will Tomorrow program. There's a lot of confusion out there about Satan, about evil, about the forces of evil. One of the latest trends in religious thought is New Age theology, which is an attempt to combine various elements of Eastern and Western religion. One of their beliefs says that Satan, or Lucifer, is really a being dedicated to man's redemption. Notice this from New Age prophet David Spangler in his book, Reflections on the Christ. Lucifer works within each of us to bring us to wholeness. And as we move into a new age, which is the age of man's wholeness, each of us in some way is brought to that point which I term the Luciferic initiation. He even goes so far as to say, Christ is the same force as Lucifer, but moving in seemingly the opposite direction. But what is the truth? Maybe we should start by looking more closely at what the Bible has to say about Satan and his influence. The Bible is, after all, the most complete reference book on the subject. I said earlier that Christ had no difficulty believing that Satan is a real being. How did he know that? Well, Christ has been present from the beginning. To understand about Satan, we have to rehearse his origins too. Remember, Christ said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. So Satan was at one time at the throne of God, and all before the creation of man. This is clear from Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 14 and 15, where Lucifer is spoken of this way. You were the anointed cherub who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created till iniquity was found in you. Now this angelic being, along with another, covered the throne of God with his wings. He and the second archangel had a unique position among the angelic beings in God's service. God's throne was shown in pattern to Moses when the tabernacle was built in the wilderness. Exodus chapter 37, verses 7 and 9 tell us about it. He made two cherubim of beaten gold. He made them of one piece at the two ends of the mercy seat. The cherubim spread out their wings above and covered the mercy seat with their wings. But Lucifer sinned, as we're told in Ezekiel 28 and verse 16. You became filled with violence within, and you sinned. Therefore I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God, or the throne of God, and I destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the fiery stones. Notice that Satan and the physical ruler he influenced, according to this verse, were involved in a great deal of violence, that characteristic of man's world we've seen already. Now, what was it that Lucifer, who became Satan, which in Hebrew means adversary, what was it that he did to justify removal from office? Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 13 and 14 tell us, For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.